A few videos back, I was telling you about the interface segregation principle, which is the eye of the solid code principles. And what we're saying with that was that it's a good idea to have small, stable interfaces. So have an interface that just does a small number of things. And we looked at some ways of achieving that. But one of the ones I didn't mention is to use a language feature in C#, which is a thing known as extension methods, particularly extension methods for interfaces. So what I thought I'd do this week is just quickly show you some examples of extension methods in general, and then show you how you can apply them to interfaces and thus help with the interface segregation principle. So what I'm going to show you here, if we look at this program, I've got this string simply called long identifier name. And the problem I want to try and address here is one that you encounter quite a lot when you're doing particularly full stack development, where you're using a mixture of different languages, that different languages have different naming conventions for how identifiers, variable names, method names should be put together. So generally, certainly for public methods in C#, we use what is known as Pascal casing, which is what we can see there, where each new word is given a capital letter. We can't put spaces into identifiers, and so we make it easier to read by putting a capital letter to identify each new word. Alternatives that we have, though, if we're writing in JavaScript, we tend to use a slightly different thing called camel casing. Camel casing because the capital letters provide these little humps in the middle rather than having one at the beginning as well, which is what we have in Pascal casing. And then another type of casing we have is what's used in HTML and CSS, which is what is known as kebab casing, where everything is lowercase, but the gaps between words are indicated with a dash. And so this is called kebab casing because it looks as though all the words have been slid onto a kebab skewer. So that's what we're trying to do here. And what we'd like to have is just an easy method that if we take, say, Pascal casing in this case, we could convert it to, let's say, kebab casing. And we might want to do that a lot. And I can tell you straight away, that's something that certainly in .NET Core is built into the system in many ways. So this isn't probably something you have to write for yourself, but it's quite a nice example of one of these extension methods. So I've got this separate DLL that I've called case converters. And in there, I've got a class called extensions. And when it comes to extension methods, actually the name of the class itself, of all places that we have classes in C#, the name of the class here is the least important. You can really call it anything you like. We'll see why in a bit, but calling it extensions is therefore quite a common thing to do. So we make it a static class, and what we can do in there is we can put into that a public static method that's going to return a string, and we're just going to call this to kebab. So this is going to convert, say, Pascal casing to kebab casing, and we'll put in the string, and we'll call that, let's just say, input. And actually, for now, I'm just going to do this without it being an extension method, just write an ordinary method to do this. What we're going to need is a string builder, and then we'll simply loop through each of the characters in our input, and then we're going to say, if C is greater than or equal to capital A, and C is less than or equal to capital Z, so if it's uppercase, and if bob.length is greater than zero, so if we're not at the very beginning, because we don't want to put a dash in at the beginning, then we'll simply say bob.append, and then we'll put our dash in. And then we'll do a bob.append, and we'll put our character in. So every character goes in, but if it's an uppercase character, it's preceded by a dash, unless it's right at the beginning of the text. And then finally, we'll just do a return, and so we do bob.toString, and it should all be the lowercase, so easiest way to do that, if we just put our to lower at that point. And then back in our program, we'll say string kebabbed equals, and then extensions gives us the namespace there, and then dot to kebab of name. And then if we print out the two of them side by side, we can see we've got the Pascal version and the kebab case version. But at the moment, that's not an extension method. That is simply a static method. And the problem with it is, it's not necessarily obvious to someone using a string that that is available to you. Because if I just type name dot, obviously we don't get that two kebab on there. We get a number of other things, but we don't get two kebab. And so it's not obvious that we've got it there. So to make this into an extension method, all we have to do is back on here, we simply add the keyword this. Typical of C#, reusing a keyword. You can kind of see why they've called it this, but it's not the same as this in lots of other situations that you'll be familiar with. So now that we've done that, we can actually hear, now we can simply say name dot, and we've got two kebab in there. And so what's happened is, although strictly speaking, kebab takes a parameter called input, we've actually moved that parameter out of there and we've put it before. So it looks as though kebab is a method of the string class, but strictly speaking, it's not an extension method, but it just makes the syntax nicer. It makes it easier to find in terms of IntelliSense, and it works in exactly the same way. The thing we can see, though, is what I mentioned. The name of the class is now completely irrelevant because that class name extensions, although obviously we've got to have it there where we declare the class, we never use it at the point where we're actually using the class. So we just say name.toKebab, so we need the name of the extension method. We do need to have the name of the namespace, otherwise it won't know what that is, but the name of the class itself just disappears. We've just got to have a class in which to store all of this. And so what you'll find is that with an extension method, whenever you declare it, with this first parameter marked with this to be of the type you're extending, so here we're extending string, but we always call it with one fewer parameters than we declare it. So for example, suppose here actually we decided to make this a bit smarter and we had char replacement, and then rather than always replacing it with a dash, we could replace it with some different character, then here I would need to provide that. So if I wanted to actually go for what's known as snake casing, another type of casing where the separator is the underscore rather than the dash, then we could see we could do it like that. But the thing is, it's always called with one fewer parameters than it's declared because the other parameter is provided on the left. So that's just rather a trivial example of how we could write an extension method if we were doing this to kebab again and again and again, and we wanted an easy way of associating it with string. Now let's look at how that fits in with the idea of the interface segregation principle. And if you remember what I had for that, I had this program called Turtle Display, which had a library, a couple of libraries, Turtle Logic and Turtle Shapes. And if we run that up, we had this idea that we could select one of these. So if I select line there, we can see we're using the turtle graphics to draw a line. And the way that worked was, if we look at this interface iTurtle, when we were strictly obeying the interface segregation principle, we had got this iTurtle down to this very simple interface up, down and move. So you can either have the pen up or down. If it's down, it's drawing. If it's up, it's not. And then you can move to a location. And with those three methods, you can actually draw anything you like. Then what I've got here is an example of us starting to breach the interface segregation principle because we've added another method into the interface, in this case, draw line. And the problem was that that's the thin end of the wedge. Once we've got a draw line method, we're going to end up adding a draw circle, a draw square, draw triangle, and you've no longer got the stable interface that you wanted. And every time you change the interface, even if your client code isn't interested in drawing circles, they're still going to have to build with the new interface. Now, the way we solved it in the previous video was to use actually the strategy pattern. So I introduced this idea of a shape interface, and we instantiated that to draw circles and lines and so forth. So that was one way of doing it, but what I wanted to show you here was another way of doing it that doesn't require this separate interface, can be done entirely through the iTurtle interface just using extension methods. shapes. So if we go to this other library called Turtle Shapes, you'll see in here I have another class which, because I don't care what the name is, I've simply called extensions. And what's going to be a bit different here is what we're going to extend, rather than being a class, we're actually going to extend an interface. And this is something that turns out to be a very common use of extension methods. And so let's steal a bit of code. Let's actually take that line code that I actually had in the turtle and I don't really want anymore. So if I just steal that line code, that draw line, let's also remove it from the interface. So we're now back to a small stable interface that just does what a turtle's supposed to do. But let's put that into our extensions. And so we're going to have a draw line, but it's now going to be an extension method that extends the iTurtle interface. Okay, and what can we do with the turtle interface? Well, we can do up, we can do down, we can do move, and that's all we need to have to draw a line. So all I need to do here is just change that slightly. So it's turtle.up, turtle.move, turtle.down, turtle.move. And now, back in my turtle display, if I go to the turtle form and go down to the draw line, you can see here that was previously calling the method in iTurtle draw line that I'd just removed. But now it's not working. But it will work simply if we introduce the appropriate namespace. So I'm already referencing this turtle shapes. If I just get that namespace, so now we've got the namespace in there, and now we've got the extension method, and we're able to draw the line. So when I run that up, the draw line will work. And so what I could go on and do is simply add further ones of these. So they're calling draw circle, draw square, and draw triangle on our turtle interface. Now, again, we don't want to be expanding that turtle interface to make it bigger and less stable. We want to introduce these as extension methods. So I've actually done most of the work here earlier. If I just go into this text file and let's steal our draw square, our draw circle, and just pop them in here. The important thing about these is none of them really does anything remarkably new. All they're doing is calling the up, the down, and the move in various different ways. So there's no need to add any functionality to the turtle at all because we're using the functionality it's already got, but we've added it effectively to the interface by using these extension methods. So now back in the form, we can see all of those things work. The way we can tell their extensions is simply what we've got here, the little down arrow in the IntelliSense. That's what tells us we've got an extension. But apart from that, just looking at the code, it's not really obvious at all. But now when we run that up, and now we've got all of these things being drawn, but they're being drawn through the extensions, not through methods of the interface itself. So it's just an alternative way of solving the problem we had before with the interface segregation principle. Once we've got our narrow, stable interface for an iTurtle, we don't want to be adding new methods. Previously, we saw one example using the strategy pattern, which in certain cases is going to be a perfectly good way to go. Or here we've seen another approach by using the extension methods. And bear in mind, these extension methods don't all have to be in the same class or even in the same library. So we could have different providers just adding their own extension. So when somebody wants to draw a pentagon, they could do it entirely in their own DLL. And as long as we reference the DLL, have the namespace, then we can say turtle.drawPentagon, and it will just fit in seamlessly. And the place in .NET itself where this is most widely used is on interfaces, and not just on interfaces, in fact on generic interfaces, and the one that we've been looking at quite a few times in these videos, the IEnumerable. So if we go back to the program here, and if I just put together something like a list of ints, doesn't matter what's in there, but if we look at ints dot, we can see it's got listed here in a separate namespace in system.link. All of these very, very useful extension methods that we've seen before, things like max and so forth. And we talked about some issues with this in the video on IEnumerable versus IQueryable. One of the things to remember here is that extension methods are statically bound. But even so, very, very useful. So if I wanted to get the max of all of those ints, I would simply have to do something like this. But the important thing is, if we look at max, then we can see it's this keyword gives us away. It's an extension method for our IEnumerable of int. And so that's what gives our extension method. So we've seen there, we can use extension methods either just on a single class, like we did with our two kebab on the string class, or we can write them as extensions to an interface, which is a very useful way of avoiding breaches of the interface segregation principle, or we can just use the ones already provided for interfaces like IEnumerable. Hope you enjoyed that. Do subscribe, do ask any questions, anything you'd like to see a video on, do ask it in the comments section, and I'll see you next time.